Where am I supposed to look?
Good evening, everyone. The time has just gone 8:15. Nice to welcome some new faces onto the screen. Sean Mattison, you have put together a remarkable panel for us tonight.
Hey, Howie, how are you doing?
Fantastic. Great to see you. Tell us about this amazing panel.
Yeah, so we've got a really fantastic panel. I can't take all the credit for having put it together. I have to give a lot of credit to Batya Bricker and Josh Sevitz. But we've got Scott Goldberg, who I see just joined. Scott, we're extremely honored to have you on here. Scott really is a real powerhouse in the world of education. He's a tenured professor at YU. He's got multiple degrees. We'll talk more about that during the course of the evening. And one of the things that really is important, is the chairman of the Corin Publishers Educational Editorial Board. So he's published on teaching and Hebrew teaching and teaching kids with disabilities. So it's a real privilege to have Scott, and we welcome you, Scott. Really good to have you. Then we've got Elizabeth Nadler-Neer, who's another real expert in the field, speech and language therapist, also has an MSc. And she works with a team of language specialists to help school teachers with the challenges in reading and expressions of language, and really leading people or helping people crack the code of reading. So we're really excited. Laura Hamburger from the UK, who's the director of the PJ Library in the UK. And how are you going to appreciate this? Laura spent some time with Harold Greenspan. She's going to talk to us about him later.
It's Lauren, not Laura.
Lauren, sorry, Lauren, sorry, apologies.
If only he could read, Lauren.
Phew, past the first hurdle.
Lauren, 1,000 apologies, sorry.
No problem.
Luckily, this is the pre-show. We're only going live at 8 o'clock, so it only matters after 8 o'clock if he gets your name right.
And then, of course, Batya Bricker, who's a GM of marketing exclusive books, but a publisher, a teacher, an architect, and the director of PJ in South Africa. So that's the primary panel. And then some tremendously important Jewish South Africans who are making a real contribution to the community, particularly the broader South African community, particularly in the context of lockdown. Ricky Lyons, Pam Cantor, Karen Kaimovitz. So we've got a great evening ahead of us, Howie. We're very excited.
Fantastic. That's amazing. And I see Danny Kadar has joined us. Danny will be on controls this evening. Evening, Danny. Your lighting is looking good. Your reflection is looking good. So the time is now 12 minutes to 8, and we're going to go live in about 13 or 14 minutes time. And Vicky Friedman, welcome. You were not one of the people welcomed by Sean on this evening. Did you arrive on this panel by error?
Definitely not by error. Maybe I just wanted to be part of this esteemed group of people, and I cannot profess to have any of the skills that any of them have. So wonderful just to be here with you. But no, we're just going to be talking about the show that's coming up on Sunday, which is Voices of Tomorrow, which is our kids in the community, along with other kids from all over the country, who actually auditioned. They responded to an audition call that we put out for not only talented kids, but kids who have voices that need to be heard in more ways than one. So we've put together some of those children, some are kids, some are teenagers, and they are going to be performing songs or dances or bits and pieces of what they're talented at, but also really talking about causes that are important to them and what their hopes and dreams are for the future. So we just thought that it was time for some uplifting and hopeful entertainment that allows people to escape a little bit, but also allows them to see that our youth are amazing, our kids are amazing, that we can learn so much from them. And I think that feeds so beautifully into what you're doing tonight. So thanks for having me on and for letting us tell everybody about the show on Sunday. And I'm sure you're going to have a fantastic panel.
Vicky, we're going to raise some decent money on Sunday as well for a very worthy cause. So tell us a little about that.
Yes, so the whole show is in aid of Tusa Arts, which is a group of performers and producers that came together as, you know, when lockdown happened, to support the performing arts community, to support traditional drummers, dancers, buskers, corporate dancers and performers, because all of us have been out of work properly now for more than 5 months, and we will only very, very slowly be returning. Theatres are still closed, events cannot happen, so the Tusa Arts charity initiative is helping all of those performers. Yeah.
So fantastic. We're going to be raising some decent money, and this is what, the fourth program of entertainment I think we've put on together since lockdown began.
Yes, yes, Howard. Such a pleasure to do this with you, giving us the.
So we'll talk a little more about that just after 8 o'clock. And we want to welcome and get some of our guests to turn on their microphones and let's have a chat before we begin at 8 o'clock. So Batya Bricker, tell me something. Is Exclusive Books delivering during this period? How do I get hold of books if I don't want to go into a store?
In lots of ways, Howard. The first is on Uber Eats. So just like you would order your hamburger and chips on Uber Eats, you can now do that with a book. So you click onto the app, you find your nearest store, and in an hour, you will have the book that you want, hot and ready to read at your doorstep. There's always online, there's always phone in, and that we introduced during lockdown, but Uber Eats is perhaps the sexiest.
So there are a few books that I do want to read. I don't know if you've read them. The one is Dorf Fedler today sent me a message to say his next series of his biographies is out, and I'm dying to get my hands on one of those. So I presume you have them in stock already at Exclusive.
I'm delighted, and I actually have no idea, but I'll be finding out while we speak if it's on the shelves.
And the next one is Bill Bryson's book, The Body, I think it's called. His latest one's out. So I've actually been seriously wondering how I get my hands on those books, because lockdown is supposed to be a time of watching Netflix and reading. I haven't got around to it yet in the last 5.5 months. Sean, I don't know if you have, but it's my intention to begin reading during lockdown.
So Howie, I've got Bill Bryson's The Body up here. So if for some reason but I can't get it to you, I'll get it to you. It's a fantastic read.
Well, I'll tell you, the Bill Bryson book, in fact, is in the top 20 bestsellers over the course of lockdown. So we saw such an interest in books that reframe your understanding of who we are, of what we're made up of, perspectives, etc. And Bill Bryson's was one of them. So it was topping the charts all through lockdown and will continue, I'm sure.
So that reminds me that Ricky Lyons has a copy of one of my books, which I need to have returned. So Ricky, let's turn on your microphone.
Do you speak to people who don't return books?
No. I should have gone to shall we say it's Yuval Harari, it's Sapiens. And I don't think anyone has not started each of his three books, but I'm not sure if anyone's ever gotten to the end of any of them.
Maybe that's why your book hasn't been returned.
Exactly. So Ricky, what are you reading during lockdown?
I'm reading about three books at once. So I started The Body, but haven't finished that yet, but it's brilliant. And Bill Bryson. I've got a book by a girl I was at school with a year below me, Melissa Mayo, that I won in a raffle the other day. So that's interesting to see. It's called Miracles Manifested. So at the moment that's what I'm reading, but Sapiens will take a while.
So Pam, let's hear from you. What are you reading during lockdown? Well, your mute is still on.
Yes, there we go. Hello, everybody. How are you? So I'm very boring. I'm into children's books.
That's so boring.
I prefer children's books, and that's what I'm doing. So yeah. So especially for this project that I'm doing, I've been doing all the Roald Dahl books and sending them to all the different communities. But yeah, at the moment, that's basically where I'm concentrating on kiddies books and sending kiddies stories out to all the different communities.
So I don't know if you know that Harry Potter has just been translated into Yiddish.
Wow.
I don't know if Batya is stocking copies of Harry Potter in Yiddish or if it's a big, big seller within the Exclusive Books world.
Not yet, Howard, not yet.
Yeah, there may be a bit of a language barrier there for me, to be honest, but it sounds quite exciting.
It's a good time to learn to read in Yiddish. So Karen, let's talk to you. What are you reading during lockdown?
Hi everyone, nice to be here. I've just actually finished my master's in Jewish education, and so I wish I'd had time to read anything that wasn't related to research and Jewish education and that whole part of my world. And so I'm really looking forward to sitting down with something soon. And I suppose I'm going to have to look back at the top 10 at exclusive books and start working my way through that list.
There's a delicious list. You won't be able to choose.
I can't wait. But the book that I'm really waiting to also sink my teeth into is what we now know about Jewish education. So I'm still stuck there. But we're getting there very, very, very slowly.
So let's do an international roundup of what people all over the world are busy reading. So Scott, tell us what you're busy reading and where do you join us from?
Sure. Well, thank you very much for having me from the other side of the world. It's very nice to be with everybody and hear all the wonderful work that you're doing in South Africa. I'm joining from New Jersey in the U.S. And I am... if you'd like to know what I'm reading, I have two major endeavors. One is I'm still trying to plow through Ron Chernow's Hamilton. Having loved the musical, I cheated and saw the musical before finishing the book. But as anyone who's been working through the book knows, it is potentially a lifelong endeavor.
So you know how it's going to end.
I'm anticipating. I'm really practicing my prediction skills, I'm awaiting the last shot. So we'll see what happens. It is quite the book, and engaging, but something that you can't really just read for fun, we'll say. On the other side of the world, I also spend a lot of time actually in my consulting doing leadership coaching. So I have become a big fan of Marshall Goldsmith and his book, Triggers. Anybody who's working on personal growth, whether it professionally or personally, would definitely find that book one that is both engaging, but also quite practical.
That's remarkable. We're going to go live in about 4 minutes. So we've got about 2 minutes each to ask Elizabeth and Lauren what they're reading. So Elizabeth, let's start with you and find out where in the world you are and what are you reading?
I'm in Cape Town, and I'm reading Eckhart Tolle's New Earth. So just the sort of mindfulness to keep from going completely out of Meshuggah and off the planet. And then the big bird battle between the bad hardy dars and the foul guinea fowl, which is a children's book.
Fascinating. Lauren, tell us where you are and what you're reading.
I'm in London in the UK, and I just finished Hadley Friedman's book, The House of Glass. And Hadley Friedman is she's an American born, but she's a British based journalist for The Guardian. And this is all about her grandmother and her three siblings who all survived the Holocaust and went four different ways. And it's fascinating, their journey through Poland, France, and then the States. I recommend it to everyone.
So Batya, if you were to give us one recommendation, one fiction and one non-fiction that you think we should all get from Exclusive Tomorrow, what would that be?
Well, for fiction, I have to say Miss Benson's Beetle. She's the lady who wrote Harold Fry's, the Unlikely Pilgrimage of Harold Fry. And it's as quirky and charming, and it's a story about self-discovery and self-forgiveness. And it's a lovely read and beautifully packaged. And then nonfiction, the book that's next to my bed is Iman Rapetti's Sermons of the Soul. I don't know if you remember, she was an anchor on Power FM, and she used to give a sermon of sorts, not a religious one, but certainly a motivational, inspirational one every morning. And they became sort of, there was a cult following to these. So they've put it together in a book, and I'm finding them incredibly inspiring and powerful. And yes, it's what Elizabeth was talking about, just a little bit of groundedness every night before I go to bed. So I recommend that.
Remarkable. Sean, what's next to your bed?
Howie, still, I haven't finished from last Saturday night, Putin's People.
Still not.
Still not.
It's a big book.
Yeah.
Night reading.
And the FT weekend. I'm still finishing the FT weekend, so I'm nearly there. I have to have it done by this weekend.
are you a hard physical book or a Kindle person?
I'm a physical book.
And very and much Vicky, so. Vicky, yeah. On your side?
Just because I find I'm on the go a lot, I love audiobooks, but I do love to read definitely nonfiction, and I don't mind actually hardcover or softcover.
And digital? Let's ask our panel by a show of hands. Does anyone prefer a Kindle over a real book? Raise your hand. Isn't that really amazing to see? So now, ladies and gentlemen, the time has just gone 8:02. We want to welcome everyone on behalf of the South African Jewish Report. Tonight, believe it or not, is the 50th webinar that we've had through lockdown. Sean, it is a great honor to have you hosting our 50th webinar. Isn't it unbelievable that we started this with one single webinar, not knowing if it would be successful, what, about 5 months ago?
Yes, how we remember that fateful board meeting when we said, what should we do during lockdown? Let's just do a webinar, see what happens.
Exactly, a webinar. Well, our webinar was fruitful and multiplied. So a huge welcome, and I'm sure there are prizes for people who've watched every single one of the 50. I know my parents have. I don't know about anyone else out there. So maybe you can use the chat. We'd love to know two things from you in the chat. Number one, we'd love to know where in the world you are, as we always ask. And number two, we'd like you to guess, of the 50 webinars that we've had so far, how many of the 50 have you actually watched yourself? I'm sure there's a huge prize for anyone who's watched all 50 of them, but I warn you just one thing: if you claim that, we may have to test you on the contents of all of this. So talking of reading, and tonight is all about reading and encouraging your kids to read and how best to do it and whether you have to physically put them on your lap or not, or if there are alternatives. But talking about reading, you'll see behind me is an image of the South African Jewish Report, and our latest edition came out online last night. And you can do one of two things. You can either pick up a hard copy. I'm happy to tell you that you can get it for free at most exclusive books. You can also go to your Spar, your Pick and Pay, your hypermarket, your Woolworths, your Dis-Chem, and pick up a hard copy free of charge there. Or alternatively, if you're unable, you're not going shopping or unable to get one of those, you can also get it online on www.sajr.co.za. So let's repeat that. www.sajr, which stands for South African Jewish Report, .co.za. We have about 40,000-50,000 people every month who come onto our website and download a copy or read the edition. And in hard copy, but you'd be impressed to know we have about 36,000 people who read us every week, which makes us larger than the Star newspaper.
Does indeed.
So we're so delighted that we have such a loyal following on our website in hard copy, as well as through our webinar series. So please, very importantly, get your copy or the latest copy of the Jewish Report. You won't regret it. And this week, our cover story is in fact about some of the South African connections to the deal between Israel and the United Arab Emirates. So not only is the Jewish community in Dubai run by Ross Creel, who's a South African from Johannesburg, but the pilot who just flew the first ever flight between the two countries just happens to be a South African as well. You can probably see him in the picture behind me. And the major kosher caterer in Dubai turns out to be South African as well. So there are many stories that you'll want to pick up in the Jewish Report this week, and we strongly encourage you to, in fact, go get a copy either online or in physical hard copy. But now we've got two amazing webinars coming up in the next few days. It's a busy week, Sean, because we're having webinars on Thursday night, we've got webinars on Saturday, and so let's tell you about Saturday. We have actually gathered the best photographers in South Africa, legendary people like Paul Weinberg, and people like Jodie Bieber, who's had front cover Time magazine photographs, and photojournalists like the head of the Sunday Times' photographic department, Alon Sky, and Ilan Ossendriver, and Ginger with a GoPro, and Josh Rubin, who took the photo that you're busy looking at the moment. So we've gathered about seven of the country's top photographers together. They're going to be showing us what they've been doing during lockdown. And not only that, they'll be talking about some of their greatest work and the role of photographer as activists at times like this. People like Ginger with a GoPro, Chad Nathan, in fact, took his images of people literally starving during lockdown and asked for money and raised more than R500,000 in literally a few weeks to help support people during lockdown purely based on his photography. So in order to register, you'll see there's a link over there, and Danny will in fact paste the link into the chat section now. That will be at 8 o'clock on Saturday evening. So we look forward to seeing you all through the lens of 2020 vision on Saturday evening. And then on Sunday, Vicky Friedman, you have put together an unbelievable showcase for all of us. Tell us what's going to be happening 3 o'clock on Sunday afternoon.
Yes, thanks so much, Howard. On Sunday afternoon at 3 o'clock, we are launching Voices of Tomorrow, which is a concert featuring incredibly talented kids from all over the country as well as within the community. And we've reached out to a larger community, and all of these kids responded to an audition that we sent out, an audition notice. And we picked some of these kids, not only for their incredible talent, but also because they have something very important to say. So these kids are speaking out about their hopes and dreams for the future. They're bringing us positive messages. They're showing us how brilliant and amazing they are, not only in their brilliant talents of singing and dancing and acting and presenting, but also in what they have to say for themselves and how they really do teach us. These kids are incredible. And of course, we are raising money for TUSA Arts CEDE on Sunday, so the kids are helping us to do that. And TUSA is, of course, supporting performing artists. So it really is a beautiful circle of how we can help each other and support those performers who are out of work at this time due to events not happening and theatres being closed. And so please join us, and it'll be a great afternoon of entertainment for the whole family.
So Vicky, this is the fourth time we've put through a variety event like this. The others have been unbelievable. We've had audiences of 8,000 people watching us at a time when we've done this, but you've really managed to bring together the best talent in South Africa. And this time we're going to be focusing on the youth. And although you and I will be introducing the session, we're going to turn off our cameras and we're going to hand over to the kids, and they're going to actually run the show for us.
That's right, Howard. You know, we just thought, let's hand it to them. They've got so much to say and they're so capable. And it's great to take a step back and put them in the spotlight and to help such a worthy cause. And thank you so much to you at the Jewish Report for giving us this platform, and to your incredible audience that tunes in and supports us. And we love doing it. And thank you. Thank you so much.
So Danny has in fact placed in the comment section right now, you can go and see the link. You can click on that link and register. We also sent out the WhatsApp and the emails today. So please go register 3 o'clock on Sunday. And Vicky, at the start of that show, you know, we've been running a shofar blowing competition. For those people around the world who don't know it, we are determined to find the best shofar blower in all of South Africa. And we have asked people to mail in videos of themselves blowing the shofar. And you're going to be seeing a few of our entries in another moment. But what we'll be doing on Sunday, just before the kids start their show, is we'll be showing you some of the youth who've all entered the shofar blowing competition. And we've put together a collage of youngsters, 5-year-olds and 6-year-olds and 7-year-olds and teenagers, all blowing the shofar. And we'll be seeing that on Sunday as well. But in order to show you what our competition has been like, please remember, you can send entries into webinars@sajewishreport.co.za. And let us now look at a few of the entries that we've received in the last few days.
Mm-hmm. All right, all right, all right, all right.
Tikiya. Shivering. Chirua. Tikiya Gadola.
Duh. Winning. My.
So Sean, oh my, oh my, oh my, that was some impressive shofar blowing, don't you think?
Yes, I'm worried about how we're going to pick the winner, Howie.
Well, you know, my money's still on Rabbi Chazdan and I haven't showed his entry yet. But every few days I get a new version because he's been practicing his lungs. And Benji and I have a bottle of whiskey on this. I've offered half of my bottle to Rabbi Chazdan if he wins. Benji's offered him two bottles of whiskey if he throws the competition.
I look forward to the judging, Howie.
Thank you. Just a reminder to everyone at the bottom of your screen, you'll see two buttons. One says chat. Please feel free to chat amongst yourselves and to comment as we go. And the second is a Q&A button. If you have any questions for any of the panelists, please stick it in there. Sean will be monitoring that and will be posing any of your questions to the panelists as well. And with that, Sean, I get to take the night off. And I turn off my camera for the first time in 50 sessions. And I probably go lie in a bath and watch you on my laptop.
Hey, wonderful. First of all, thank you for everything you've done for all of us in the community over the last 49 webinars. And you deserve the night off. So thank you very much. And welcome to everyone. And I think we've got a fantastic evening ahead of us. Just before we begin, we're going to have a really good conversation about reading and some tremendous work done by the PJ Library. So please, as Howie said, do use the Q&A. But I just want to say that tonight's evening, we really want to make as a tribute to Harold Grinspoon, who we'll talk more about later, but who is one of the most remarkable philanthropists, Jewish philanthropists around the world. And then the South African PJ Library program is done in memory of Daniela Mofsen. And so we'd like to dedicate this evening's webinar in her memory. So that's what we're going to do, but we've got four exceptionally talented and esteemed people that are joining us. Very briefly, we've got Scott Goldberg from New York. He's a tenured faculty member at Yeshiva University. He's a real expert on education, reading, teaching children with learning disabilities, and is the chairman of Koren Publishers Education Editorial Board. Elizabeth Nadler-Neer, who's a speech and language therapist, also has an MSc, works with a team of language specialists around schools and children with reading disabilities. And Lauren Hamburger from the UK, who runs PJ Library in the UK, And of course, Batya Bricker, who runs PJ Library in South Africa. She's the GM of Exclusive Books, is a publisher, teacher, architect. So we've got a really great panel, and thank you everyone for joining us. I wanted to start, Elizabeth, with you. And we've all been through around the world months of lockdown, and some of us are starting to emerge from lockdown. But throughout lockdown, screen time has become something that's really dominated our lives, in particular our children's lives. Talk to us about screen time and reading, and is this a good or bad thing for us?
You know, Sean, I have continued my practice. I've continued to be able to work with children and teach reading challenged children through screens. So they're the greatest blessing. But there are correlations between high number of screen time hours and language skills. And language skills are at the core of reading. From the moment a child hears language and starts to speak, you know, reading is learned on top of our language skills. And the more screen time, the lower the expressive and receptive language skills. And those kind of studies that have looked at meta-analyses, looked at lots and lots of stuff, have all shown that. But there's the flip side. It all depends on what the screen time is about. So the higher the educational kind of screen time. And this for me is what I talk to parents about all day, is that co-viewing, that mediation by parents. And that is associated with higher receptive and expressive language skills, which feed into higher literacy skills. So it's not a zero sum game, you know, it saved us screen time. So yeah.
Fantastic. Scott, from your perspective and your experience working with children, what's your sense of screen time and what it's doing for kids and learning and reading in particular?
Sure, thank you for having me. And certainly understand things very similarly to the way Elizabeth does. I think I saw a lot of shaking heads on the panel. Just to add a few points, in addition to the general correlation, general pathway that the language development is somehow not as great because of screen time, that there's impairments or there's some type of negative impact of screen time. It's important to understand what that screen time is. Those studies are not only about television screen time, but those studies are also about gaming consoles and how language and literacy score outcomes tend to be lower the more time you are gaming. Again, even when that is with peers, so there's some paired component of that, most of the time parents are not sitting there mediating with, you know, expressive language, receptive language, while children are playing games. Oftentimes the gaming is actually somewhat of an escape from that for many, many kids. So I think it's really important to realize that when we talk about screen time, it's not just a particular type of screen, or it's not just computer time, it's not just television time, all of which have the potential of negative outcomes, but it is also gaming. I think it's also important to recognize that tablets, there is some research that suggests, similar to what Elizabeth was saying in terms of some of the educational opportunities when it comes to screen time, tablets, particularly when there's adaptive learning environments where children are able to interact with early, basic early literacy skills, phonological awareness, the sound games that they'd be playing, some of the early alphabetic principle ideas of being able to connect and trace letters or be able to interact with sound symbol correspondence have shown actual very positive outcomes in the last year or two of published research. So I think it's important to realize it is nuanced, like Elizabeth said. It is a little bit more expansive in terms of the types of screens that we might be talking about. The more we can have interaction, as Elizabeth said, the better that interaction, certainly mediated by parents in terms of language, but also in terms of adaptive educational environments.
Great. So talk to us, maybe Elizabeth, a little bit more about the importance of reading in education and the importance, not just in reading for its own sake, but in the overall development of children.
I mean, that is It's a very huge kind of question. It's a no-brainer, okay? And I work with kids who struggle to crack the code, okay? But I can see within 5 minutes, when I work with a kid who can't even read one word, they might be 8, they might be 10, but I know that they're literate because they have families that read to them. Okay, they've got broad vocabularies. You see some of the children I work with, they hold chapter books under their arms saying, I'm going to read this one day. They're hungry for it because that's what's there in their environment. So reading is, yeah, language and reading is at the foundation of learning. And you can be literate, I will say, with having huge reading challenges. Somebody even asked a question just now about listening to audiobooks reading. And I love the question, and I'd love to hear what people think about it.
What do you think? Do audiobooks count as reading?
Listen, I have debates with my husband all the time about this because I didn't really come from a big reading family. We had mouth stories, you know? I've got 7 siblings. We sat around the bin, we told stories, so when I got married, he would put a pile of books next to my bed and he said, just taste. And I became an avid reader in my very early 20s. And I've got a family of dyslexics. So I've got dyslexia in my family. So I've seen, but we're all highly literate people. We're all language strong. So now he's getting on in age and he falls asleep when he's reading. So he listens to audiobooks and he says he reads many books a week. And he does. So he would argue it's definitely reading. It's absorbing language. So I think it's enriching your language, your literacy. Maybe Scott will expand on that.
Sure. Scott, I think you can expand on it by saying it very much in line with what you were saying earlier, Elizabeth, which is it depends on how you're engaging with the audiobook. So if you're engaging in the audiobook passively, so it's language development, just the same way you'd be conversing perhaps, or not even conversing, just receptive language. And you might get some really rich language exposure through those audiobooks. However, if you engage the audiobooks the same way we would engage a written book, thinking about the skills of reading comprehension that we would want to develop in young children and as adults even, summarization, sequencing, connecting to self in terms of making those self connections, being able to make predictions, comparing and contrasting, all of those wonderful skills that we oftentimes relegate to post-textual study as opposed to making them part of a really rich language study, whether it's around narrative stories, audio or otherwise, whether it's around the opportunity to be able to just have someone just tell a story at the dinner table or the like, and also being able to think about a more expository topic, more conceptual topics, news and the like. I think it's important to realize parents, educators, we all in the community have the opportunity to engage each other to expand our literacy outside of texts.
Yeah.
So Scott, I want to just go back to that broader idea of storytelling. And I know you've done a lot of work of the importance of storytelling in overall development, particularly moral development and spiritual development. Tell us about the role of storytelling and to a certain extent, what roles children's books play in that process.
Sure, I love that question because it's a very, it's the cross-section of what so much of us enjoy about stories, that there are lessons, that there are opportunities to be able to gain those lessons for our lives, as well as to teach lessons through stories. So many of the intergenerational opportunities that to a certain extent have been lost in terms of being in person intergenerationally with families have been gained by technology, connecting through video and otherwise with family intergenerationally for people to talk about situations in which they've been in pandemics before, situations in which they've been quarantined before, challenged before with health or otherwise. It's given opportunities for families to tell stories so that they can pass along the legacy of their family, but also the values of the family. That's really critical. And that's one of the components of what stories do. What's fascinating about the research on storytelling is that it also intersects quite nicely with the research on not only values transmission, but transmission of belief in God and belief in those values. So it's fascinating for, I think, a Jewish community in thinking broadly about storytelling is it has a great impact values-wise, spiritually, potentially religiously as well. And there's some fascinating research studies that have been done, both singular research studies and meta-analyses, as Elizabeth was referring to earlier, that look at the role of storytelling in communities where storytelling is natural. So let's say a Native American storytelling and certain the Yucatec Maya, for example, as a community that's been studied greatly around their storytelling, where they have ritual storytelling, and how it is that that impacts the transmission of that community's values, as well as the transmission of their belief. And very young children, because of that ritual storytelling in the study of that community particularly, and it's been extended in others, but I think it's a good example, have been able to, in a very early early development, recognize there's a difference, for example, between what God can do and what man can do. And that they develop belief through storytelling. So early on, they figure out that God makes mountains, but man makes buildings. God makes rivers, but man makes machines. And that through storytelling, they're able to transmit that belief system, which again, very much is similar to any value system. Whatever those values are, to embed them, not only in a story, but in regular storytelling. And it's not only about storytelling, it's about ritualizing within your family. So if that's around bedtime stories, that's wonderful. If it's around a dinner table, that's wonderful. Whether it's at some other time when you're on a long road trip, that's wonderful. Again, the point is that you are narrating your value system, that even if it's in a book, you're still narrating it for your children. You're helping them understand how it fits into your life. And if it's in your life and it's a story from your life, you're making it real and practical for your children so they understand that this is a value because it's a recurring theme.
Wonderful. Elizabeth, give us a sense of in your work, how you've seen storytelling help in moral and overall development with children.
Well, I'll start personally, because you know, it all comes with that connection. We used to have a story called The Bateman Ship, and my father used to have each of us as a character, and we'd thrash through moral issues. And behaviors and stuff in the story. And I've just kind of used that in terms of just sort of the academic side of it. Children's stories, their ability to narrate a personal story, a personal narrative at 2 and 5 is highly predictive of conceptual development and academic success. And you think, really? But if you think of telling a story, it's kind of from listening to stories, from reading stories, you learn the schema, you learn the outline, you learn how a story works. And each culture actually is quite culturally specific. So in our sort of Western culture, there's a beginning, there's a high point, there's a problem, there's a resolution or not. And a kid's ability to tell a story is very predictive, but it's very developmental. So 2-year-olds do heaps, you know, and mommy and a dog came and then can I have my milk? You know, they're unrelated. And then by 2 and 3, there starts to be some cause and effect. I'll chew on my finger because I fought mommy, you know. And then by 4 and 5, we start to actually get a plot. Kids are able to narrate personal experience. And that is through, and you see kids learning it much younger if they come from literate families. And of course, the moral and the spiritual and the teaching in there is endless. Just Google children telling stories, narrating stories on YouTube, and you see 2-year-olds reading full stories in gibberish, and you get the whole point of it because they understand the schema because they've been read to.
Amazing. Well, that's a great segue to talk about the PJ Library. And Dan, if we can put Lauren's camera back on. And Lauren, if you can tell us about PJ, perhaps more generally, because I know when you were in the US, you really engaged with it. and in particular, what you're doing with it in the UK.
Sure. Hi. So thanks very much for inviting me to be part of this tonight. So PJ Library actually launched in the States around 15 years ago by a guy called Harold Grinspoon. And his coming from it was really, he heard about the singer Dolly Parton, who I'm sure most of you will be familiar with, who set up a program called Imagination Library. And she was giving away free books to kids from underprivileged families who couldn't afford to buy books. And he thought that was a great idea and he wanted to support them. And then he started having a think about kids in his own community. And he realized, you know, we don't have a literacy problem to the extent that some of the communities that Dolly Parton's program was supporting, but we often can have an identity problem. And families may not feel confident to teach their own kids about Jewish values and traditions. So he came to his board and he said, I would like to set up a Jewish imagination library. And they all laughed at him and said, that'll never work. And now it's in 29 countries and goes to something like 750,000 children every month. And the premise for those who aren't familiar is that every month a child aged 8 and under, or the case in the UK, it might be slightly different in South Africa, gets a free book in the post celebrating a different Jewish value or tradition that they get to keep. And they build their own Jewish bedtime libraries. And we pick all the stories that, you know, I was listening very, very much to Elizabeth, what you were saying about the progression in age and how it goes. And, you know, for our 0 to 2 year olds, these are the types of books we're sending. They're hardback books and they're just learning the word todah there. And, you know, they repeat the word throughout the book of what todah means to kids and kind of the value it can have. And then that progresses and they'll get a nursery book for 3 to 4 year old. Here's one about making challah. This one is a really cute one, Little Red Ruthie. They took the familiar story of Little Red Riding Hood and they turned it into a Hanukkah story, and she defeats the big bad wolf with latkes. And books that are, you know, much more interesting or challenging texts for then 7 to 8 year olds. And I was living in New York for a couple of years and I happened to stumble across this program at the local JCC. And I thought, oh, that sounds nice for my daughter. You know, we're pretty affiliated, so I don't know if we need it, but it's free. And I always appreciate a good kids book, I'll sign up. And I was blown away by the type of book there, because the offering of the Jewish book was on par with the non-Jewish books that were available for children. And previously in England, I'd kind of steered away from Jewish children's books because they were really for the ultra-Orthodox community and they didn't reflect so much where we were coming from. And the PJ Library books really want to reach out to everybody. So they're cross-communal. We have worked with 45 publishers worldwide we've over 600 titles. So the books themselves are really broad ranging. And then I moved to the UK and, you know, everyone's asking, oh, how's it being in London after being in New York? And I said, you know what, if I could do one thing, it would be to bring PJ Library to the UK, because it is amazing for every Jewish family. It doesn't matter if they're totally affiliated or totally unaffiliated or somewhere in the middle. Everyone can learn something. And the beauty is you can learn it at that time that's so precious, that kind of 10, 15 minute bedtime reading window in the evening with your kid or whenever it's appropriate, you know, for the parents. And so we launched in the UK then 5 years ago. And then it was really exciting a couple of years ago when South Africa came on board. And actually we work very closely with the South African team. We share a book selection committee and we often talk about titles and, you know, issues in them and things we love about them. So it's always, you know, where can we find the next great book to share with our families?
Tell us a little bit about Harold. I mean, he himself was dyslexic, was he not?
So Harold is a very interesting character. He turned 90 last year, and to celebrate, he went white water rafting. And there's very few people in the world that would do that. And he is passionate about Jewish continuity. And he recognizes that, he heard some fascinating data that says, you know, the first few years of a life, of a child's life is what's going to really determine about how they develop educationally. And so he said, you know, what are we waiting for? Why are we waiting till they're 20 something to go on birthright, or teenagers to go to Israel on a tour trip? You know, we should be talking to them and celebrating Jewish values from birth. And so he said, right, that's what I'm going to do. And so the books go from birth. And, you know, like I said, there's the very simple board books up to the more complicated ones. And he is very smart. There's a whole load of research out there. And it's really about convincing someone to do something that they kind of want to do anyway. And so a parent wants to read to their kid. Generally, you know, especially Jewish families that we're speaking to, they want to read to their kid. They appreciate the value and the importance of reading with their children on a regular basis. We as a wider community would love it if families are talking about Jewish values. So let's bring it together. Let's give them the Jewish story to read while they're reading to their kid. And then instead of reading, you know, the Gruffalo or whatever is the favorite book in South Africa for kids, they're reading, you know, this one, which we just sent out about the chameleon that saved Noah's Ark, you know. So this is, yeah, it's an Israeli story that we've had translated in English because it's so brilliant. And get parents talking to kids about Jewish values. And what he did that was even more clever was he helped parents along the way, but not in a patronizing way, in a very deeply respectful way. And he does this by the beginning of every book has what's Jewish about this book, what's the Jewish message? And at the back of every book is next step, something you can do in home that's Jewish as a family. And there might be a craft or a recipe or a song you can download or whatever it is. But he understands that he wants to make it for families to talk about Jewish ideas and Jewish and the chagim and everything around it in a way that's not threatening and that feels fun for kids.
Amazing. Scott, what advice do you give with the program and the books to parents to really get the most out of this experience with their kids?
Well, I just want to also say I've known Harold and have had the opportunity to be with him. He is not only an inspiration in terms of his philanthropy, but his inspiration, as Lauren mentioned, in terms of his energy and his exercise regimen, which is probably why it is that he's able to go whitewater rafting at 90. I would just say, as much as we're talking about literacy and opportunities for parents to engage children in that, I think we should take a page out of Harold's book as well and make sure we're engaging our children in not just sitting and reading, but also getting out and enjoying nature and enjoying the world that God created and being able to experience that with children in a very, very real way as well. That's another one of Harold's legacies. And I think it's important to note that in this time. In terms of what parents can do, I think we've spoken a little bit about it already. I'll just, just underscore how important it is for children not to just be reading alone, although that's a very important part of their development. But it's also important for parents to be reading with their children, to be able to check what it is that they're getting from the book, to be able to also read to children, not just have children read themselves. Sometimes the texts that they're written are written developmentally appropriate for the age group in terms of content, but for some children, maybe dyslexic or may have other language challenges, reading challenges, it might be difficult for them to actually decode the book. So parents who are reading to their children, being able to model for them the reading, I think these are all really healthy and appropriate ways in which parents can engage with the program from a literacy perspective, pure literacy perspective. In terms of the values, as Lauren mentioned, PJ Library does such a good job of the kind of pre-reading and post-reading experiences for children on the front cover and the back, or front inside and back inside covers. I think that parents who also engage their children just in talking again, summarizing, pulling out the ideas that the book is engaging with, making a connection to something that's in their lives, being able to talk about other books that they've read that are similar or that have similar values, similar ideas, are all wonderful ways for parents to engage this. Have also just another piece of this is having older siblings read with younger children, being able to make it so that families are reading these books, I think are really wonderful. My wife grew up with a ritual where they read a book, same book with different lessons on Friday night at their Shabbat table. And you know, being able to have a book being read on a regular basis by a family to pull out those values so that everyone can talk about it. It's not just a parent-child piece, but it's a family piece, I think is another wonderful way to engage PJ Library or any book within the home.
Wonderful. We're going to show a short video on PJ in a moment, but we've had a question, Elizabeth, from the audience. At what age should you read to your kids? Until what age, rather?
Until what age should you read to your kids?
Yes.
Until they say, get out the room, mom, I want to read on my own. You know, follow your child's lead. And if a child can't access text and they're at the age where actually developmentally now they are pushing you away, then get them audiobooks. Yeah, so I think, Scott, I saw you nodding. Would you?
I agree. I also think that it's not only when they kick you out, but I think it's wonderful when adults share with other adults what they're reading. Think about book clubs. Okay. It's so natural nowadays for us to think about book clubs as a way to be able to share with our peers what we're reading, how we're reading, and what we're gaining from books. Within families, be able to say, hey, I'm reading this. Listen to this wonderful, you know, descriptive language that this author just used, and bring that again to the couch where everybody's sitting and reading their own books, you know, being able to bring that to a child and share the excitement about your own development of what you're reading and sharing. Not just that it should be tucked away in your nightstand, but it should be on your nightstand. It should be in the living room, on the coffee table, that they should be seeing that you are actively engaged in reading process. And it's not just the one genre, that it's just the narrative, but they're also seeing you partake in literacy activities that are throughout your professional life, your personal life. And I think it's really critical that you do that. So yes, I agree completely, Elizabeth, that until your child kicks you out of the room, you should be reading with them. But I would also say that kind of peppering one's life with literacy moments is something that can really benefit the entire family.
Yeah, and I would just to add to that as well, Elizabeth mentioned, Scott mentioned, sorry, about the book clubs. And I think what's very special about PJ Library books is that every child is receiving the same book every month across South Africa, and then actually in the UK, in Australia and America as well, because we all follow the similar book cycles, we're all choosing the similar books. So, you know, a friend of mine, she set up a book club for five of her daughter's friends, and they meet up regularly and they just talk about a PJ Library book, and they make sure that the parents bring a few prompt questions, or each of the kid brings a question to it. But, and these are the older ones, the 7 or 8 year olds rather than the 1 year old, but they're all getting the same book, and it's an amazing opportunity. You know, what did you think of the drawings and the illustrations? What was the message that you thought? What's Jewish about this book? What could we do next? What could we do at home that's different? You know, so there's loads of things there. And the one other thing as well, just to do with reading, that is fascinating, that is kind of a conversation starter that we often use when we're talking about books, is them being both mirrors and windows. And when we're choosing, you know, looking at PJ Library books, we want them to be, can be either. They're either that they can be a mirror, and so they can reflect something that you do in your home, you know, whether it's something we're sending out this month about Rosh Hashanah or another chag, or whether it's a window onto something that you don't know. So maybe you're Ashkenazi and you're learning about a Sephardi tradition, or maybe you know, you're in South Africa and you're learning about a tradition. There was one of the book in Australia about koala bears and a rabbi, which was very cute. So there's always opportunities, either that they can see themselves reflected in the book, which is hugely powerful, and I'm sure the educators know a lot more than I do on, and the also idea that they can be windows onto the world that you don't fully know within the Jewish world itself.
Wonderful. We're going to talk to Batya in a moment about South Africa, but Danny, if you can cue that first video we've got on the PJ Library, just to share with everyone.
A warm hello from PJ Library. In a world where schedules change from week to week and monotony threatens to squash your spark, we are proud to introduce Read, Connect, Dream. Think of it as a magic formula for engaging with your child in a meaningful way, ensuring parent-child bonding, igniting imagination, and instilling lifelong, worthwhile habits, all in one. Research shows, and no doubt your experience confirms, that young ones benefit from a reliable and regular routine. A routine offers security and comfort, something to look forward to, a never-changing anchor in an ever-changing sea. Read, Connect, Dream is about carving out special time to do the things that really matter with the people who matter most, all without a screen or Zoom or smartphone. Because you see, there is no replacement for you spending quality time with your child, distraction-free. There is simply no app for your lap. PJ Library invites you and your little one on a Read, Connect, Dream adventure all winter long. with webinars, read-alongs, prizes, and of course, quality Jewish books. Reading gives us a place to go when we have to stay where we are.
So Batya, tell us a little bit about PJ in South Africa. How many kids get it? How do they get it? Who provides it? And there is a question, someone's asked, why can't you get it for 1 or 2 year olds?
So PJ Library was launched in South Africa in 2019. And with the very generous donors behind it, we're able to gift 3 age groups with a book a month, a beautiful, beautifully narrated, beautifully illustrated Jewish book that they can add to their collection. So it's a book a month for 8 months of the year, making a huge difference to a Jewish library and the Jewish and the presence of Jewish books in the home. Before the program launched, they did research and found that around 23% of Jewish homes in South Africa, only 23% had Jewish books for their children. And if I can echo what Lauren said, we had a very similar situation here where the Jewish books that were available were very far on the religious spectrum. And so they didn't really represent the broader community or appeal to the broader community. And they were in many ways substandard in terms of narrative and in terms of illustration and quality. And so what PJ Library has done has completely changed that. The books are of an international standard. They're beautifully illustrated. There's no cringe factor if perhaps the values don't entirely echo yours. And so that has changed. And we know that from the research that we've done since the launch of the program, where around 80% of the families using the books use them to learn about Judaism, to learn about Jewish thought and belief, and then to spark conversation. So it's been incredibly successful. I did laugh at the comment that, you know, PJ Library exists in Israel as well. And they were talking about their selection process. We have our own selection process, and there are a set of unique circumstances in South Africa that we take into consideration. Of course, the books that we choose need to be age appropriate. They need to be of a certain standard. There needs to be a narrative quality that you want to read it again. Rhyming always helps, a sense of humor always helps. And of course, on the religious spectrum, we have to get that right. That appeals to the broader South African Jewish community. But in Israel, they were talking about choosing a Shabbat book. And they said it took them 5 years to find the right Shabbat book to easily and comfortably cross over all the different sort of segments of Jewish community in Israel. So we don't have quite the same challenge. But we are very careful to make sure that we balance fun and then food for thought, because books and reading books and your time when you're spending with your child reading books should be fun. It just should be a special, close, incredibly special time. And so the book has to be fun and entertaining, but we also like to make sure that there's a layer of depth, that if you want to have a conversation, if you want to talk about things further, if you want to learn more, the depth is there.
So tell me, I know the program is run by the South African Board of Jewish Education and the Herzliya schools. Does it go to all Jewish kids? How do kids make sure they get it?
So it's inspired, because all you have to do is sign up and you get these books completely free. So it is restricted. We look at nursery school, grade 1 and grade 2, which is what our program allows. The international program goes on for much longer, and I wish we could do that, and perhaps one day we will. I know there was a comment by one of the attendees that, you know, she wishes that the program continued beyond grade two. But I thought I would just bring an interesting trend that we're seeing in international publishing, in children's books in general, is that picture books are becoming quite commonplace for older children to read picture books. And that's it's related to a lot of things, but firstly, because of the incredible quality of picture books, but also because of the kind of content that's being published in picture book format now. We call it the Greta effect, but you know, gone are the days where you would rotate Roald Dahl, with respect of, and love, of course, for Roald Dahl and Dr. Seuss and all those classics. But gone are the days where you would rotate that on a constant basis, you know, sort of every night. The range of books now that are being published more and more are books that talk about self-love, and they talk about love of the planet, obviously, and the environment, but they also touch on all the social issues that children are dealing with. And, you know, nothing is taboo. It's like from IVF and fertility to bullying to identity. You know, we're seeing in South Africa, for example, there is now a slew of books being printed on kinky hair, on black hair. Because these are the issues that people are dealing with and are trying to work through with their children. So the books that we choose for PJ Library do the same. And in fact, you can be reading picture books, which used to be traditionally for 3 to 6 year olds, now way beyond that. You know, they're much older children are reading them. There's depth to the stories. You can read them at various layers. So to the attendee who wanted more books, I say go back to your PJ Library books and carry on reading them beyond. But the PJ Library program in South Africa at the moment goes to, they gift 2,500 books every month in Joburg, in Cape Town, Pretoria, PE and Durban. And that's with the help of the engine that sits with Andy Hendler in Cape Town and Lauren Pinstein in Joburg, but then all over the country. And I did giggle to myself, no, we don't use the post to send the books like Lauren does. We don't have that luxury. But we work through the schools and we work through a pickup system, and all a child needs to do to qualify is to be within the age group, to be a Jewish child, and to sign up.
Amazing. And I just wanted to say again that we did do tonight's webinar in memory of Daniela Mofsen, because some generous donors are providing those 2,500 books in her memory. So I just wanted to remind everyone of that. Just moving on a little bit to Ricky, I mean, we know, and we've spoken about the power of books and the power of reading, and it's been an acute challenge for the whole country during lockdown. And I know you've been doing some very important work, and we'll get to Pam and Karen in a moment, about assisting teachers and other educators throughout South Africa. Tell us a little bit about what you've been doing. Are you on mute?
Thanks, Sean. Sorry. Thanks for having me. I am a trustee of a trust called the Support Teacher Empowerment Trust. And we provide, we fund bursaries for, it's a BEE trust, and we provide bursaries for teaching students. And we also provide training for teachers. And we do that in partnership with Ought South Africa and Ought Cape. And during lockdown, we realize that we have access to hundreds of teachers through our partnerships. And many of them obviously were at home, or most of them were at home. And kids in mainly township areas were also at home with nothing really to do. So through our network of teachers, we wanted to assist them to get some kind of reading material to the kids who weren't at school during lockdown. So two of the partners that we partner with are on the panel, Karen Keimowitz from Ought Cape and Pam Cantor from Summerwood Primary School, who also started Read for Hope. And they both have methodologies that we've been able to give or provide to our teachers and our teaching students as resources to help the kids in their communities to have access to some kind of reading material.
Fantastic. So Pam, I know you're doing something tremendous in Read for Hope, which kind of pivots on some of the ideas we were talking a little bit earlier about audiobooks. Why don't you tell us a little bit about what you're doing and how it works?
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much for having me. So as Ricky said, I'm a teacher at a public school and most of our children are underprivileged. And during lockdown, our kids had no online learning. And it was breaking my heart. And I just decided to come up with this initiative where people could send in videos or voice notes via WhatsApp. And I could send those stories to the children. And it went viral. And I'm sending to over 300 communities, different schools, orphanages, the visually impaired, the deaf communities, all over South Africa. And it's just been an absolute hit. People have loved it and it's grown from strength to strength.
So I just wanted to pick up on that, Scott and Elizabeth. I mean, one of the potential devastating consequences of lockdown is kind of education inequality and challenges for kids being able to read, us both at a socioeconomic level and kids with reading difficulties. What are you seeing from your perspective, maybe Scott, starting with a bit more of an international perspective of what's happening to help and what should people be doing, particularly with kids which are having learning difficulties and struggling?
Sure, so maybe we should start by talking about the magnitude of the problem. So early research over the last several months suggests almost a double in the Northern Hemisphere, double summer slide. So for those not yet there at your summer slide, anywhere from a 5 to some of the research goes up to 18 to 22% drop in literacy outcomes in the second half of the academic year in the Northern Hemisphere. So that's a challenge, obviously, and that's probably the magnitude of the challenge. Obviously, the higher end of that loss is largely attributed to students who have language deficits, who come from homes where they are not necessarily language rich or literacy rich homes, lower socioeconomic status homes where there aren't as many resources. There is an opportunity to go online, as Elizabeth said, with regard to tutors or with others in communities where they don't have even the devices to do that. You know, many, many communities that went online made an assumption that the homes would have the devices to do that. And throughout the world, that's not necessarily the case, as you well know. So that's the magnitude of the problem. I think it's helpful to define it that way. I think obviously initiatives like Pam was describing are hugely helpful. Rich language, in whatever form it comes for children, is going to be helpful. For those who have reading challenges, I think that there are interactive apps that are available. And again, there's no app for your lap, as we said. So it's certainly the opportunity to be able to, whether you're using PJ Library or any other text, to the extent to which parents are able to read to their children, wonderful. To the extent to which they're not, while it is that it's not ideal, again, utilizing screen time, whether it's utilizing YouTube or whether it's utilizing other internationally accessible libraries of children's books that are even read out loud and recorded children's books, well available. Again, on many of the services like YouTube and the like, you're able to get the book with the pages turned being read. So accessing that kind of, those resources are helpful for children to be able to pull up those deficits. Obviously, there are apps that are particularly available for children who have difficulty reading, that break down the phonological phonemic awareness, build up some of the alphabetic principle and fluency. But I'll leave it to Elizabeth to speak more specifically to some of the interventions that she might be familiar with and access for children.
Yes, Elizabeth, that would be incredibly helpful, particularly here in South Africa. You're still on mute.
Yeah, so.
Okay, great.
What I have seen just in my practice
This is my garage. I've just put some flowers behind me and I've got some Harry Potter and the Sorting Hat behind me, but I had to change my garage. So it was hard to get to the children, and I've got my books all in. And I thought, how am I going to work with these children? And it's quite extraordinary how many of the kids have not had readers. Now, in order to read, especially in the early stages, you have to wire up literacy. So if you don't read, you're not wiring up your reading, and you are. So I'm seeing a slide. I haven't done any research, and Scott, I haven't read that research. But of the children that I'm working with, especially the grade ones and twos, I'm most worried about, because they don't have the readers at home and the teachers haven't been sending the readers home. So I've got an external camera, and we read books. And if the printer's too small, we on the cell phone, I say, take a photograph of it, send it to me, you reading on that side, and we pair read. So the cell phone is unbelievable. Take a screenshot and read. Copyright, sorry, all of that. But you know, you do what you can. I will read on the back of a cereal box and share my screen, but the cell phone seems to be most extraordinary. And for the teachers to send the readers home, I think they just stopped. The library's closed. So we've got a lag, and especially in the community that I serve, the delayed readers and then the delayed disadvantaged readers. I've worked with an online remedial reading program where we can share screens. So there are many, many apps, but they're not always available because people don't have the devices or the airtime.
Sure. So we've got our work cut out for us to close this gap, which maybe we'll talk a little bit about in a moment. I just wanted to make another point just to clarify some confusion on the chat, but the PJ Library is available to all Jewish kids, whether they're at Jewish day schools or not. And so feel free to sign up. So Karen, can we talk a little bit? You're with Orjet in Cape Town. You were telling us before we started that you're completing your master's in Jewish education. Tell us a little bit about some of the work that you've been doing in terms of helping through the lockdown period.
Thanks, Sean. Thanks for having me on tonight. I'm with Ort SA Cape in Cape Town, and basically our mandate is to train and support teachers in disadvantaged communities across the Western Cape, which was great and all until we had lockdown. And suddenly we were in a position where it's very difficult to access teachers living in areas where they have no data, they have no devices, they have no ability to be able to connect with us. And so we had to start adapt. One thing we're really good at Ort is being adaptable and flexible. And so we had to adapt really quickly. And what we did at that point is we were very lucky in our time. We were able to access our beneficiaries, and we have a huge group of 180 interns that are sponsored by corporates through this year. They are ECD intern and teacher assistants. And we accessed them, all of them, through WhatsApp. And we started at teaching and working with them in literacy and working, allowing them to work with small groups when it was safe. And so the moment that they were able to start working with small groups, we had trained them up to be able to work and become a role model in literacy and good receptive and expressive language and storytelling for these children. And so we found a conduit to be able to reach kids in school, where in areas where schools were completely closed and they were unable to access any form of teaching and definitely any form of literacy. A lot of the parents of these children are themselves illiterate. And so we had to find ways to use our teachers in our training programs, as well as our interns and those in our learnerships, to be that conduit and find a different way in. Those mainly are people who are teaching in the foundation phase and in ECD schools. Another one of our programs that we have, but in 2015, we devised at Ort a reading and comprehension wheel that we have given out to many schools across South Africa. Ricky's schools have had this. I actually have one in front of me here. This is the hard copy. And so we were able to work with this reading wheel to especially in the schools that Ricky was working in, to actually improve the comprehension and reading for understanding of those older learners. Because in South Africa, we have a huge percentage of children who get to grade four level and are not able to read for meaning. They're just able to read. And even if they're able to read, that doesn't mean that they understand what they're reading. And at that point, we started working with the grade three teachers and the grade four teachers as well to be able to teach them how to teach children to read. And so our reading wheel is an incredible resource to be able to help those children. And we have it on the app as well. So we had that app so we could use both. But really what it is was addressing the poor literacy rate through going back into the perceptual skills, into their understanding of the importance of emergent literacy and being able to access those that weren't able to access education in those very difficult months.
Great. So can we pick up on this idea of reading for meaning and philosophy for kids and where does fantasy fit in? How does PJ, either Lauren or Batya, deal with this question of fantasy in stories? And perhaps the Gruffalo has some wonderment about it, but how does that fit into the PJ choice of stories?
So if I can answer from a South African point of view, fantasy plays a big role, but it needs to be within certain parameters. So we have lots of debates about, you know, say you have a book about a mouse who keeps Shabbos. Are we okay with that? You know, it's a mouse. And is that something that we want to promote? It seems inane. And a lot of the feedback we've had from books like that we've chosen is how children put themselves in the place of the mouse, for example, and relate to the mouse and the emotions of the mouse. And it's a way of exploring new ideas, new feelings. It does echo what's happening internationally in children's publishing as well. We call it sitting at the edge of your bed books, where it's books that explore uncomfortable ideas, scary ideas. So they're scary, but just a little bit scary, not a lot scary, a little bit scary. So that a child can try on their fear, they can watch a character develop through it, and then they can come to their own conclusion. When we choose the PJ Library books, we certainly look for those life situations that children can relate to. And, you know, perhaps that they can put themselves vicariously in a situation that they can try on. It was what Lauren was talking about, the mirror or window, that sometimes the PJ Library book mirrors what you do at home, but perhaps it also provides a window into the way somebody else celebrates their Judaism.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that, if I may, that I think the beauty of books for everybody, for all of us, is that it is this place that you can go to that has no limits in terms of imagination. And that's fun for everybody. I mean, you know, for adults in the past 5 months, it's been vital that they've had somewhere to turn that isn't looking at the news and all of that. But for kids, it's great. And Harold's favorite book is actually a book called The Schmutzy Family, which is a brilliant book. And it's about this poor mother whose kids are always making the biggest mess imaginable. On Monday, they make a mud pie in the house, and on Tuesday, they empty all the leaves somewhere, and they go through the days of the week, and it's very cute illustrations, but, you know, come Friday afternoon, everybody does what they need to do and tidies up and cleans the house. And on Shabbat, they all put on their finest clothes and they go to shul, and it's a day of rest from, and it's a day of beautifying everything, and then back to Sunday and they're all being a disaster again. And it's a hilarious book, but it also allows kids to make that mess that they're probably, that extreme mess that they're about to do. You know, and I remember we were talking about it as a book selection committee, like, is this going to encourage every kid to bring the mud in and, you know, smear on the walls? And are we going to end up having hundreds of parents call us saying, what have you done? What mess? But it, you know, it doesn't, it just, it's a fun book, and it just takes reality and just takes it on a few notches while still talking about The Shabbat is a different day and separating it from the rest of the week. And I think that's what's really special about books for kids of all ages.
Lauren, I am interested to know, because in South Africa, I think we're a little more conservative with fantasy. And because also we're spanning a spectrum of religiosity in the children that we serve, we do need to be careful with some things. So, for example, like zombies, is that something that you can choose? Because we can't.
Yes, we can choose zombies. And I think I even know the book you're talking about, The Zombies Visit Israel. Oh. Yeah, which is a great book. Yeah, so we but also there's, you know, the UK is still pretty conservative compared to the United States of America. So even then, there's some books that we won't choose, and there's some books that won't work. And there was one book all about the American Civil War, and the last page was, and they killed 400 British soldiers. And I was like, yeah, we can't send that book. The families here, this is not gonna work for us. So you have the ones that work for your own community.
So moving on from the wars, Scott, just to go back to this idea of philosophy for kids, is that something that's age appropriate? Is storytelling a way to approach it, or should we be leaving it for the later years?
It's a very, I think, a very personal question. I mean, developmentally, you obviously have to know your children, you have to know young children, right? So whether it, maybe moving away from war, but whether it's anxiety that your children might have, or fears, or just, you know, they might have a certain disposition towards certain topics that you know better than anyone else. So I think before any national or international person might say this is appropriate, inappropriate, the number one thing to say is that parents know their children best, better than any of us ever will, and parents should be making that decision for what's appropriate for their children or not. The extent to which any value is particularly something parents want to discuss with their children. So again, it comes back to the same fundamentals of literacy and language development, which is parents interacting with their children and making sure that even if something is a little bit over their head, a little bit beyond them, that they're able to, you know, discuss it with them. Oftentimes we put our own anxieties and our own fears onto children. Full disclosure, I'm a psychologist by training. We sometimes put those fears on them as opposed to really understand that some of the questions they ask, you know, really aren't as deep as we think they might be. You know, why does this happen? Or does that happen? Doesn't necessarily require a major philosophical conversation about the meaning of man and God or the world or the like. Sometimes it's just as a simple answer. And again, I think that that's where we sometimes put on our children the expectation that we have to have absolute clarity on something, and we need to be able to discuss it in full-blown, you know, discourse, as if this is a college university course and discussion. We need to know our children, and we also need to know that topics don't need to be discussed at length. The other piece about philosophy, which I think is important to help with the curiosity of young children when it comes to reading, is that it's okay not to know something. It's also okay not to answer a question, to say, you know what, let's hold that question for now, and maybe we'll discuss it later at the end of the book, or maybe we won't. And it's okay to go to bed at night with questions and wake up the next morning curious. That's something that parents can also gift their children.
Right. Yeah. Walter Isaacson, in all his books around innovation, he picks the greatest innovator is Leonardo. And what does he pick that's so distinctive about Leonardo is his curiosity. So it's been an extraordinary evening, and we can carry on for some time to come. But I two points, maybe, Karen, there's been a few questions and requests where people can get hold of that reading wheel. I don't know if you can give some advice. How do people get to it?
I will put my email address into the chat right now, and you can always contact us. What I didn't say earlier is that it's actually available in English. On one side is English, and the other side is either translated into Afrikaans or Xhosa for now, and hopefully Zulu in the near future, so that second language learners can also use it effectively. And so I will put my email address into the chat right now, and anyone can contact me for further information. With pleasure.
Great. So we're going to wrap up in a moment. So if anyone has any questions, please do post them on the Q&A. But maybe just to get some final thoughts about maybe just some advice, how to make reading fun and how to make it really count. Elizabeth, maybe give us your thoughts and advice for everyone listening out there.
You know, for me, it's being authentic and know your child, know yourself. If your kids are a budding architect, let them snuggle with you and show them designs. If your kid's a budding ballerina, find stories. I think we've got to try to match interests. And also, the best person to read, you know, to tell the stories might not be you. It might be Safta. It might be the older brother. Rope people in. It might be the housekeeper. I think stay flexible and ask other children. I'm always asking children, what are you reading at the moment? What are you loving? I think know your kid and ask. Be curious.
Fantastic. Lauren, yeah, what's your... Yeah. Oh, sorry, go for it, Batya, go.
Just to say, just from a personal experience, I'm a big reader, which is no surprise. And I read to my child a lot. Our third boy has a reading deficit. And so I'm still reading a lot to him. And we've just finished The Beast of Buckingham Palace, the new David Walliams. And what was, for me, it really illustrated the magic of what books can do, because we read about Buckingham Palace. I mean, David Walliams is just rollicking good fun, you know, and he's funny and he's disgusting and it's toilet humor and it's all the things that children love. But at the same time, we explored Buckingham Palace. We then went, Aaron and I, because it was mentioned, we then went to the British Museum and we did a virtual tour because we're in the middle of COVID and so we could do that. And then we discussed Queen Victoria, because it's set during that time, and the fact that she wore black after her husband died. And we started talking about different cultures and how different cultures mark their mourning. So for me, a book, even if it's just good fun, can be a portal into a great adventure. And I loved it as much as he did. And I think that's where the magic is.
Fantastic.
The beauty as well with David Walliams, as I was reading with my eight-year-old son, is that he rarely uses the word said, and it was such a good exercise, and I made my son write out every word he used instead of said. So bellowed, howled, screamed, called, and he has it just, you know, on his desk. So that there was, I think there were 50 options there in a couple of chapters alone. And it's that, you can do that with any book, you know, especially ones that are well written, where a great author will really understand how rich language can be that will excite kids. One thing that we often get is we're often people say, oh, my 7 and 8 year old, you know, they're too old for PJ Library. They don't need, the books are too babyish for them. And this is the type of book that we'd send to 7 and 8 year olds. And I can understand that a 7 and 8 year old might be reading a paperback book. So why are we sending them a picture book? And I know tonight is all about literacy and its importance. You know, PJ Library is not just about literacy. PJ Library is about storytelling and conveying Jewish values. And it's important for the parent or the grandparent or whoever it is that's reading with the child to sit and read this story and to talk about the values and the messaging and the historical element or whatever it is that's going on, because it is going to be a more complex story. And it's not just about, you know, whether they can do it on their own, but it's really about asking those questions. And what's amazing is then, you know, that there are then things you can do at home afterwards, and especially with PJ Library books, because they relate to Judaism, you know, you can, the ones that are going out, we're sending one out this month, and on our website, we've then got how to braid around challah for Rosh Hashanah. So, you know, the kids will be learning about Rosh Hashanah, and then they can go on and make this round challah, and then they'll think back to that book they read. And then when they're reading that book again for the second, third, or 50th time, they'll think back to that time when I made round challah with, you know, with whichever family member it was. And that back and forth creates such powerful memories, not just for the child, but for the parent or the grandparent, whoever it is as well, for the guardian. So I think that's what's so special about PJ Library books, is you can identify and pick out the Jewish value or ritual or tradition, and you know, do it in your own home, or look up and learn more about it, or in your own synagogue. So I think there's a real opportunity there that kind of general children's books don't necessarily present.
Fantastic. Scott, leave us in your experience with some closing thoughts on how to make it count.
Be there, be present. I think the image of the person in the park with their child, pushing them on a swing with one hand, but with their phone in the other hand, not actually being present, pushing their child on the swing, is as prevalent when there's a parent who means well and takes a book and wants to sit with their child, but gets that text or that phone call they're like. Make it real, make it authentic, like Elizabeth said, make it about your values, like Lauren said, focus on that, but bring it to life by being present and really putting that phone, that device on the side, put it in another room. It's actually interesting research that says, even if it's there and you don't access it, it still impacts you. It impacts your child, even if you're not using it, even if you're not accessing it. So be there, be present, make the literacy alive, make it authentic. Have your own, your children will know if you're faking the excitement. Be excited, read books that you're excited about and your children are excited about, and be exuberant about it, because the earlier you're able to instill the excitement about language and literacy, the longer lasting it'll be.
Wonderful. We've got another video we're gonna show. Danny, if you can do that, and then we'll wrap it up.
I love reading because it takes me places that I could never normally go.
When I am reading, I feel happy, warm, loved, cared. I love reading and it just makes me feel happy.
I love reading and I love the adventures that I think of in my imagination right up here.
I love reading books because they help me use my imagination and they calm me down and they relax me and they fun and they teach me a lot.
My favorite author is J.K. Rowling because she made up lands and made lots of magic and dances and I like it. And like when I sometimes read in the sun and I sometimes read in my bedroom and I read at night and in the morning. I just love reading.
This book is my favorite book because it teaches me mitzvahs and giving pizzas to poor people.
It exercises my brain and it lets me learn new things.
It's helped me use my imagination and they help me calm down. They help me sleep and learn.
I like reading because it puts you in a whole magical place and it gets very, very exciting. It's kind of like watching a movie, but in my mind.
I love my PJ Lovely books because they teach me about the Jewish holiday and the Jewish life. That's why I love reading and that's why I love books.
I love books because they take me on magical adventures and I love all of their nice colouring and pictures and I really want to learn new things and I really like reading. And I'm a bookworm.
Oh, fantastic. So let me thank everyone for their time. I mean, you've been extremely generous. It's been a remarkably inspiring evening. I'm certainly inspired to go and read. A big thank you to Danny Kadar on controls, to Josh Sevitz from the South African Board of Jewish Education who helped put this together. I see Howie's returned. I was going to do the punt for the next two webinars, but Howie, that's I'm handing back to you.
No, Sean, I think you should try them. I want to try and find that book about mitzvah and pizza.
Get on Uber Eats, that's what they say.
Well, it's been an amazing an amazing evening, and I think I've learned a lot, and I've got a pile of books this high next to my bed. The pile seems to get higher and higher, it never gets shorter and shorter, and that's part of the beauty and the magic of reading. So to everyone tonight, a huge thank you. Really appreciate all of your time. Just a reminder, on Saturday evening, we're going to be talking to the best photographers in South Africa. So don't forget to register for our Through the Lens of 2020 Vision. That will be on Saturday. And then on Sunday, 3 o'clock, we'll be having our virtual concert together with the Star Academy, and we'll be watching the Voices of Tomorrow. So Danny, I'm sure you'll be posting all of that into the chat section now. And to everyone, huge thank you to all of our panelists, and we'll see everyone on Saturday evening. Good night to you all. Sean, thank you so much for doing tonight.
Thank you, everyone. Have a great evening, and don't forget to read your Jewish report. Good night.